CRISPR Cas9 system was discovered as a result of observations in the mid-2000s. And during this time, researchers who were studying bacterial sequences noticed that there were these repetitive palindromic sequences. So the palindromic sequences would then have these unique sequences that were flanked by these palindromic sequences. So the unique sequences were found to be representative of viral genomes that the bacteria would keep if and when it survived an infection. So a bacteria that had this CRISPR system would keep these snippets of viral genomes and flank it with these repetitive sequences if and when it survived an infection by a particular virus. And so it turns out these are adaptive immune responses from bacteria. These repeats would be processed and it would then associate with another RNA molecule before it can then bind this DNA cutting enzyme known as CRISPR associated. And so it's given this Cas, and it has a number. The most common one is Cas9, but you can have different Cas, CRISPR associated enzymes, which are able to cut DNA. So let's give some terminology that you encounter in CRISPR-Cas9 editing systems. So you come across Cas9, and Cas9, as we know, these CRISPR-associated enzymes can cut DNA. They can recognize particular DNA sequences when the guide RNA guides it. So then there's this guide RNA concept. So the guide RNA is this RNA that's used in bacterial adaptive responses. It's adapted for use in genome editing. So in the bacteria, it's two RNA components. In the lab, when it's used as a tool, it's combined into a single guide RNA that's about 100 base pairs of sequences that directs Cas9. So Cas9 binds to it binds to this guide RNA, and the guide RNA in turn binds to one strand of double-stranded DNA. The first 20 to 21 base pairs of the guide RNA is what gives it specificity as to which DNA segment it's going to bind. And that's where you get to program it and tell it the 20 base pairs in your genome that you want it to bind to. And then Cas9 bound to that will cut that sequence. Three base pairs from that sequence.
So I'm going to show these examples using sickle cell anemia as a genetic disease model that we may want to intervene in by designing guide RNAs to fix the genetic defect. So let's have a look at how we would go about something like that.
So the first step is to go to NCBI Entree, and there you can search for the gene that's responsible for the disease. And the sickle cell disease comes about where in the hemoglobin subunit beta, you have two thymines instead of adenines. And if you happen to be heterozygous, so you have one sequence that's adenine and one that's thymine, then that's okay. But if you have both being thymine, then that's defective and your blood cells, the shape is not as it should be, and they form these sickle structures, sickle morphology that can clog. So you in NCBI Entree, you can type in the gene that's been identified to be the cause of the sickling shape of the red blood cells. We see that it's on chromosome 11.
So the first thing then is to get the sequence of the gene, and then we need to focus on the area that we want to do the editing in. So you know the sequence of your target gene. Just knowing the sequence is not enough. You need to know the structure. So you need to know where the exons are, you need to know where the untranslated regions are, you need to know where the start codon is, you need to know if there are signal peptides, you need to know what the start site is, and so you have to look at the structure and annotate where each one is, because that's going to be important in terms of which guide RNA you ultimately select.
And where do you get all the information about your transcription start site, your 5' untranslated region, the start codon, your signal peptide, the actual mature protein, your exon-exon junction, your stop codon, and your 3' untranslated region? Where are you going to get the information from? Well, it's in your National Center for Biotechnology Information, the NCBI entry that you would have searched for the gene. So just at the bottom, it will tell you where all those information are. You can go ahead and annotate it. So you take a copy of the gene,
the sequences, the nucleotide sequences, and you can go ahead and mark off where each of these positions are. Because then when you design, when you look for your PAMs, your protein spacer adjacent motifs, you will be able to see where those particular PAMs are. Are they in a transcription start site? Are they in an untranslated region? Are they in an exon-exon junction? Are they in a stop codon? You'll be able to see that straight away, and so that helps in determining which guide RNA to go ahead with. So the untranslated regions, for instance, you wouldn't, if you're wanting to make a mutation in a gene, you stay away from that region because they're actually not translated. They do not code for the protein, and so it wouldn't form part of the final product. So if you mutate there, it's likely not to affect the gene in the way that you want it to be affected. And as you know, you wouldn't want to target an intron because the introns are definitely not coding regions. You wouldn't pick any guide RNA that's targeting an intron. Signal peptides also tend to guide the protein to the location in the cell that it needs to be. And so targeting those would not affect the protein per se, because they're more like the signal for where the protein should go. So you're not affecting the actual protein, but just the signal. So once again, it's less likely to lead to a mutation or an edit that you want. One way to design is to do it manually. So you just look for NGG motifs, and don't forget, because it's double-stranded, you can go ahead and look for the complementary strand. The coding strand can have NGG, but don't forget it could also have CCN, because the complementary strand would then be the NGG, right? So you can look for either NGG or CCN, because the GG complementary strand is CC and then any nucleotide. Then you want to copy 20 base pairs towards the 5' end. If you remember the structure of DNA, it's 5' to 3'. The polymerase reads it from 5' to 3'. So you want, or from left to right. Yeah, from left to right. So you're gonna look for the PAM, and then you're gonna go to the left of the PAM, also known as upstream, also known as 5'. There are multiple names for it, so you pick whichever name makes sense to you. But basically the PAM is NGG or CCN, and then you go ahead and pick the 20 base pairs that's upstream or on top of it or on the left hand side of it. But of course, if it's the CCN, then it's the other way, because you're coming from the 3' or the downstream, so look for the other way. If you do the manual option, you have to go into BLAST and check the entire genome to make sure that there aren't other sequences that your guide RNA would also cut. So you would have targeted, picked your guide RNA based on your gene alone, but the gene is part of a genome, a greater set of chromosomes. So you're gonna have to go ahead and blast it, go into BLAST, put in the guide RNA you intend to use, and then search the entire genome to see if it also matches somewhere else. You're bound to have matches somewhere else in the genome. So if the matches to other parts of the genome is not exact, but it has like three mismatches, it matches another part, but there are three nucleotides that don't exactly match them, that's okay. But anything less, so if it has only two mismatches or just one mismatch, or is it an exact match, then clearly that's a problem, because Cas9 is not only going to cut where you want it to cut or interact where you want it to interact, it's going to interact with the other place, which is called an off target. So you want to avoid those kind of sequences.
So an additional tool that you can use in identifying a guide RNA for your disease that you're investigating is to use ChopChop. So with ChopChop, you just go to Google and you just type in ChopChop, and it will give you an option to go to the website. And here on the website, you get to select, you just have to enter in the gene ID, which maybe you picked up from NCBI or Ensemble, if you have an identification from Ensemble. So in here, I just type in that the gene is HBB, for the responsible for sickle cell anemia phenotype. So then I go ahead and select that it's in humans, Homo sapiens, that I'm interested in.
and I'm using CRISPR Cas9. There may be other formats that you have. CRISPR Cas9 is what I select. And then you have to select the type of edit you want to do. Do you want to do a knockout? Do you want to do a knocking? Do you want to activate? Do you want to repress? And so for this instance, it would have to be a knock-in that we're interested in, because you wouldn't want to just knock out the thymine. You would, you know, and not have some, you want it to be functional. You don't want to just mutate. You want to replace it with an adenine so that you have functional, normal shaped red blood cells. So, or hemoglobin. And so I'll go ahead and select for a knocking. And once you enter that, you know, it takes a little bit of time depending on the time of day, and it'll tell you, you know, what number you are in the queue. And once that's done, it's going to show you multiple guide RNAs that is searched through the genome, through the gene to find. So you've told specifically, you've constrained it to the gene, so it will find it within the gene. And as you can see, we've got multiple here. It shows you the structure of the hemoglobin gene, which is nine. So these blue parts are your exons, so the regions that will be retained when the gene is transcribed. So the red parts are your introns, which will be removed, and the tiles at the top, the red tiles at the top, are the guide RNAs that it's recommending for you. And you won't just take what it says on as number one. You want to actually investigate what it says as number one to make sure that you're happy with where it is. So in general, you want to mutate, you want to have the, well, in this case, we're not knocking out, but you want to, if you were doing a knockout, you'd really want to be close to the first exon, the earliest exon. So in general, the earliest you can make a mutation and have a truncated product, the better. In mutating at the end of the transcript would not potentially affect the function of the protein as much. So you would want to find a guide RNA that's targeting the early portion. But in our case, we're a bit constrained. We want to be close to RS334, which is where the mutation is. So we want our guide RNA, we want Cas9 to cut about 10 base pairs around, 10 to 15 base pairs around that area. So that's where we'll be, you would want to focus on as a guide RNA. And you wouldn't want just one guide RNA, you would want multiple. So in ChopChop, you can specify what you're looking for. So by clicking options, you have a whole heap more options. And in the general tab, you can tell the software where you want to target. So generally, you want to target coding regions, or maybe you want to just target any part of an exon. So you would have these 3' untranslated or 5' untranslated regions. Generally not a great idea if you're doing a knockout, unless you're specifically looking at the effects of these regions on the protein product when you target them. So you would want to stick to a coding region if you want to do a knockout or a knock-in. You may want to take out, look at particular splice sites, or specifically, like I said, you may want to just look at your untranslated regions, or even a promoter. You may just want to see what effect the knocking out or a promoter or a person with promoter would have in your experimental setting. You also have the option of restricting your guide RNA to a region that's present in all splice variants. So as you know, you can have in a particular gene, you can have different exons being present because there's variety in that gene in terms of how it's the transcripts for it. But that could be a problem, because then if you're targeting a variant that's not present in the particular system that you're studying, then you are not going to get the outcome of Cas9 being able to edit as you want the guide RNA to guide Cas9. So you want to choose exons, target exons that are present in all the gene variants. You can make sure that you tell the software to target areas where the GC content is as recommended. So no less than, you want to look at 30 to 80% GC content. And you can even select the companies, the restriction enzyme, the company that provides you with the restricting enzyme. This is going to be important where you're going to clone these guide RNAs into plasmids for delivery into cells. It also reports a self-complementarity score, so you don't want a guide RNA where the front is the 5' end is all A's and the 3' end is all T's, because then they can complement each other and form hairpin structures. So it predicts a guide RNA that has those structures for you, so you can avoid them. Very usefully, you also have a primers tab, and this is where you can design primers for you to be able to amplify out the region that you're targeting with your Cas9 and guide RNA. This is useful because after your experiments, after you've placed Cas9 and the guide RNA into the cell, you will want to be able to characterize what sort of edit Cas9 created. So what sort of insertion or deletion, and whether that insertion or deletion will lead to a frame shift that will knock out the gene, but in our case we want a knock-in. So you always want to be able to amplify that region out again and get it. I've got a video here looking at the three common ways that you can validate your Cas9 edit, and so you'll be able to take a look and see whether you had an insertion or deletion.
Hey, if you've made it this far, I think you can go ahead and give the video a thumbs up. Let's do a recap. You can design your guide RNAs manually, or you can use a software. If you're designing your guide RNAs manually, what you have to do is obtain the sequence of your gene that you're targeting, and then you go ahead and look for NGG motifs or CCN motifs. If you're using Cas9 from Streptococcus, you have to blast the sequence that you select against the entire genome to make sure that the sequence that you like is not also targeting another gene in the entire genome, in the chromosome, in other chromosomes. If you use software to design it, it's much easier. It's much faster. The software is going to tell you, you can select, it's going to tell you what your off targets are. You'll be able to also design primers, PCR primers, to amplify out the region that you edit so that you can characterize the edit. You're not going to edit something and not go ahead and characterize it. So much more to talk about, but I think this gives you a pretty good overview of the sort of things you need to consider when designing your guide RNA. And I have to say, it's not even designing your guide RNA, is it? You're really just selecting a guide RNA from the chromosome, from the gene. Design part does come in though, because in order for you to introduce the guide RNA into the plasmid vector for introduction into the cell or the system that you're studying, you will have to append some restriction enzyme sequences to it. So that could be covered in another video, but I will have to leave it here because this is quite a long video. There's a lot to take in. So I will catch you in the next one. God bless you. Bye.